So, yeah, thank you really for this nice introduction. So, I'm continuing somehow where I stopped in my last talk, but I'm continuing in a weak sense. You could see my, you could think of my previous talk as some kind of motivation for studying a particular problem in homogeneous dynamics, classification of joining of higher rank abelian actions, and today I'll actually talk about this problem in homogeneous dynamics. So, while on once, in some sense, it's a continuation of my talk yesterday, it's actually also independent. So, I'm beginning with a group, a semi-simple linear algebraic group defined over the rational numbers, group of matrices defined by some collection of polynomials with rational coefficients. And this gives me, then I'm taking S to be some set of places, some subset, finite subset of infinity and the primes. And somehow it was quite important for the previous talk that I work in the generality, but today you would lose nothing if you just think of all of my groups being real algebraic groups. And I have inside here so I look at the points in this group over the S over the product of the local fields corresponding to the places in S, and I have here gamma inside G and inside the rational points of my group, an arithmetic lattice, and this gives me a nice space, G mod gamma, where I'm going to look at. And let me make a definition. A measure mu on this quotient space is algebraic or algebraic over the rational numbers if there exists a Q, a subgroup defined over Q, of my group G, and a finite index subgroup of the QS points of this group. H such that mu is basically the Haar measure on a single orbit of the group H, is the Haar measure on a single orbit of H on so you take H, well, I sort of explained that at least you need to make some further mild assumptions on my group H, that maybe it's a fixed point in some, it comes from a fixed point in some rational representation. Then the orbit, the image of this group H inside the quotient space, which I denote by these brackets, is going to be a periodic orbit. It will be closed in, and in the cases that I care about right now for this definition, it would actually be of finite volume, and I shifted by something. For some g in my group. That's the sort of nicest measures on the space. They are supported on some subvariety these are the measures I like. And now we're talking about joinings. So since we're talking about joinings, I take R such Q groups. So instead of just talking about G, I'm talking about G1 up to GR. And of course, in each one, I have a lattice gamma I, and I have a subgroup of finite index G inside the QS points of GI. I'm assuming that GI, so I have here GI, gamma I, say GI, and I'm assuming that these groups GI are Q simple, which in another language just says that these gamma I's are irreducible lattices. Lattices in GI. So that's what I'm assuming. I'm also assuming that the quotient space, that's sort of a minor assumption, that the quotient space GI modulo gamma I is connected. Of course, I mean, when I'm talking about real algebraic groups, I mean just that. But in general, in the case where I have some periodic groups, I guess it's better to explain what I really mean. So I mean that the group generate, so somehow the group generated by all unipotents in my group in GI acts ergodically on the quotients. Basically, again, over the real numbers, just assume that GI modulo gamma is connected on the quotient. That's a minor assumption to avoid finite index nuisances. Now, I have an acting group, A, which has rank 2, so it's basically a multiplicative group of two local fields. And, or if you wish, a compact subgroup of that, if you prefer. So that's, and then so this is one group, and somehow I wanted to act in all of these quotient space, so I need to specify how, and that amounts to the same thing as specifying. I have here R embeddings. I guess to these GIs, which is a finite index subgroup of this QS point of the Q group. These are embeddings. And phi will just be this. An embedding of A, the embedding of A into the product of the GIs. And now I can state the theorem, main theorem I want to explain today. By Einsiedler. And myself. Suppose mu is a phi A invariant and ergodic measure. Or let's say this way, adjoining on this product space. So what I mean by that is, to begin with, just a probability measure on this product space. It's a probability measure that is invariant under this acting group, under this two-parameter group. It's ergodic under this two-parameter group, which means that there are no invariant sets which have a measure strictly between 0 and 1. And this joining actually also says that when I project this measure into each one of these components, I get the uniform measure. That's what this phrase means, no more, no less. Then mu is algebraic over Q. So yesterday I stated the two theorems. When I talked about, I gave a theorem in I gave sort of one theorem for the end users, one theorem which is easy to use for number theorists. And there I assumed that the groups are different, so I don't have to worry about any measures. But you know that the conditionals are equidistributed, and you know that your joint vector is equidistributed in the big space. But the theorem, the sort of the ergodic theoretic theorem, which is at the heart of the matter, that no, but sort of like I said, you, in order to deduce the statement I gave in my previous lecture, you had also to combine some arguments that if you sort of twist your toes too much, you would get unipotence invariant in the limit and use some argument using Ratner's theorem. But this actual sort of result, which is somehow the heart of the matter, does not need to assume. It basically says that I understand completely all of the...
If you want to use this and it's the same guy twice, then is everything going to come from commensurators? Is that part of... Is that this mu? Can you actually
yes.
tell us what mu...
Yes, so it's a very concrete state. It's basically comes you're looking at which Q groups exist, which project to each one of the Q groups, and if these are Q simple groups, there are not so many choices, right? I mean, that's basically. So this is a rigidity statement. If you have some kind of joining in the measurable category, which is okay, sort of fluffy object. And you put it through this machine, you actually get something in a very, very strict sense, algebraic, and basically you could immediately see what are the possible options. Of course, if somebody gave you a measure at hand, which came from some kind of equidistribution statement, some kind of limiting procedure, where you don't even know ergodicity or something, and you need to plug it through this machine, you have to work quite hard to see in which case actually works. But on the level of classification of joinings, this is a complete story, a full classification of joinings. And the generality is fairly, as you see, essentially an arbitrary rank two subgroup. And I was actually too restrictive here. You could actually be more lenient. You don't actually need to assume that the action comes from a algebraic torus. You could allow more general two-parameter actions. Now this result...
Another thing, just for the outsiders, you know there's no positive entropy assumption.
Okay, I mean, this is exactly what I want to talk about now. So this result is a piece of a bigger project. The bigger project is classifying measures on such quotient, arithmetic quotient, C mod gamma, invariant under higher rank actions. Right? I mean, just measure classification without this joining assumption. And I'll give you a theorem which is essentially the best known in that direction. It's somehow the best known results can be deduced from that using some not so complicated algebra. It's special cases were included in early work of Einsiedler, Katok and myself. And here's sort of a theorem. So G is a key, so G is again a Q group. Let's say it's a Q simple group. So I get a quotient, so gamma inside this collection of points, of real points, or if you want to be fancy, as arithmetic points of my group is a lattice, irreducible lattice by assumption. This is a lattice, which arithmetic lattice, which is basically right. I mean, so actually, I could say here is a lattice in this QF, and now I want to take a torus. So A is going to be a torus. It's going to be a maximal split torus in some G1, which is normal in this group. So this group, it's G is Q simple group, but somehow this doesn't make it just over each local field. It's a semi-simple group. It's a product of simple groups. And of course, you have a product each local field. You have a product of simple groups, and you have also a product over local fields. So you have still some kind of product. You choose some of them, that's what essentially what this normality means here. You choose some of these elements in the product, and then I take a maximal split torus in this sub collection with rank at least 2. Right? So the total, you sum over the fields or the places of the field that appears, the rank in each local piece. You have rank at least 2. Now I have, suppose mu is A invariant and ergodic. And on this quotient space. And I assume some kind, of minimality assumption that's not supported. I want it really to be on this space and not somehow on a subspace. So I'll say not supported on a set of the form G, L, Q, S for any reductive proper Q subgroup L inside G. Now I assume another assumption that the entropy of mu, and okay, you don't really need to know what the entropy is. It is some word which is a measure and an element of the acting group, and forget for a minute what it means. Entropy is positive for some.
He's interested in zero entropy.
Then my measure mu is invariant under a finite index subgroup of invariant under. It's okay, it's algebraic, but algebraic actually is algebraic. But actually, it's not just algebraic for some subgroup, but it's basically for the whole space. That's the theorem. And you might be worried initially about this condition, about not being supported on a smaller thing. But if you're supported on a smaller thing, you're supported on a reductive thing. A reductive thing, okay, there's some torus, which, okay, depending on your point of view, is very complicated or trivial. But in any case, not so interesting from our point of view, or at least we can't say anything on it from our point of view. And you have some q simple pieces, and on each one you could apply this again, and then you basically get to the composition of your measuring to a part on which you're invariant, a part on which you have zero entropy, and a part on which rank one groups act. And maybe I'd say that this condition here, you'd imagine is unnecessary. I think it is reasonable to conjecture that it is unnecessary, and has been conjectured that it is unnecessary. Definitely. But then I restrict to the smaller orbit, I decompose the smaller orbit into a product of q simple things and the toes. I apply this theorem in each one of the q simple things. And so it's not a real restriction, it's just a way of phrasing the theorem in a more... This is just somehow a way of phrasing the theorem in a more efficient way than actually an actual restriction. And this condition, I should say, of this condition I gave here is stable under this type of restriction. I'm going to quotients. Now, so this condition is certainly sort of a well-known hard problem to eliminate it. Somehow remarkably for arithmetic applications, it's been remarkably mild. Somehow, the real difficulty in applying this theorem in arithmetic context has not been this, has never been this condition, but actually being able to rule out that some portion of your measure is supported actually in smaller things. That's as far as equidistribution statements are concerned. Actually, it's been remarkably mild, but of course, from the homogeneous dynamics perspective, that's one of the big open problems, eliminating this conjecture. Now, two pertinent, I didn't say what entropy is, but here's also two pertinent properties of entropy. So one of them is that unless A is very degenerate, so if you have A and G, so G, let's say semi-simple, gamma in G and A in G, not quasi-unipotent, sort of definitely diagonalizable is not quasi-unipotent, at least okay, diagonalizable with eigenvalues not equal to one in absolute value. Then the uniform measure for the uniform measure M on G mod gamma, the entropy is positive.
That explains the joining.
Almost. Yeah, almost. It's sort of one more thing I wanted to say, and then it exactly explains the connection between the theorem 1 and theorem 2. So maybe I would put it. Over here. And then the second pertinent property of entropy is that if I have some group A acting on two spaces, two probability spaces, and if I have phi from x to y, taking the measure mu to the measure nu, commutes with A action, then so I have here sort of what in ergodic theory is called a factor map, the entropy on the big guy is at least the entropy on the small guy. And then these two statements together exactly imply that here you would have entropy from the joining assumption, because in each one of the quotients you have entropy, and when you project to the quotient, you're not going to lose. But still, I mean, you see that I can be much more flexible in my choice of torus for the joining than for the general measure classification theorem. And there is good reason to that, which I would like to explain. Now, maybe one more thing I should say, remarks about entropy. In the, for this context of measure classification theorems, entropy is not an obvious condition to take. It is not forced to me in reality, and it does not seem to be, a priori, it sort of seems a bit surprising how it should enter into the picture. And again, I'll comment on that later. But the first person to realize that entropy is a fundamental concept in this respect, or at least extremely useful concept in this respect. Entropy and measure classification is, you could argue whether it's Rudolf or Lyons, but sort of it was introduced in the context, in a different context, slightly different context. Basically, instead of working on semi-simple groups, if you work on solvable groups, that's essentially what happens. Introduced in this context for, let's say, the times A times B problem by Rudolf, or maybe you could say by Lyons, Russ Lyons, and in the homogeneous context, so the homogeneous context of his previous work sort of before my work with Einsiedler and the works with Katok, the previous work by Katok and Spazio and Kalinin Katok. So let's say Kalinin Katok Spazio in various combinations. Okay. So now let me explain something which a key concept that sort of certainly already appeared in different formulation, but certainly already appeared in the papers by Kalinin, Katok, and Spazio. A key concept is the concept of leafwise measures. So I want to explain this concept is leafwise measures. What are these leafwise measures? So before I talk about leafwise measures, it would be some measures on some leaves of some foliation. So I need to actually on all leaves, so I just need to explain what foliation I'm taking and which measure. So let's start with the foliation. The foliation would be given by orbits of a group, very simple foliation in that respect, but then I need to talk about which groups I'm considering. So one type of group we're considering is going to be what's called the holospherical group. So for every element in the action, we can consider the contracting holospheric group for this element here. That's the elements, so that a to the n u, a, these are elements u such as a to the n u, a to the minus n tends to 1 as n goes to infinity. Right, so here a is fixed, u is a thing which is valid. These are the contracting holospheres. These are certainly groups which we like, but I'm going to actually look at a more general class, so UA. This is a class of groups you could obtain by intersecting these holospherical groups. So what I mean by that is, of course, different elements. So I have a multi-parameter action. Each one is has a holospherical group, and okay, they're sort of could be open sets in the action which share the same holospherical group. But I'm looking at the intersection of all of the holospherical groups I can get from different elements, and this is a class of groups I'm going to look at. This is a class. So each one of these groups is a unipotent group. Each one of these groups is normalized by my acting group A, and this is a class of groups that I'm going to look at. So now, and another thing is the minimal elements in this class. Of course, I'm not counting the trivial group. The trivial group is not particularly interesting, but sort of the next step up, we'll just call the coarsely Lyapunov. Coarse Lyapunov subgroups for you. Subgroups. Forget the name. I just use the name because that's the name I'm used to referring to. Yes. So for SL3, and I have SL3, and I'm taking SL3, and I'm taking the full diagonal group. These are just all of the one parameter unipotent groups normalized by A. These are somehow the groups for which we have good control over the leafwise measures.
One parameter unipotent.
Unipotent groups, definitely. These are always unipotent. So this collection of groups are the groups which sort of have nice things about the leafwise measure. This is a nice collection of groups. And in this case, where I have a maximal torsion on a split group, it's particularly nice because basically on all unipotent groups, so these are the coarsely Lyapunovs, they're all one dimensional, and then this class basically includes all of the unipotent groups normalized by A. So in this case, we sort of are very happy because all of the groups are nice. Let's say in a case, suppose I had a group like which locally looks like a product of SO and 1s, for instance. If you have locally product of SO and 1s, then these are much bigger groups and life is more complex. So now I told you what foliation I'm taking. I'm taking foliation of orbits of groups in this class of nice class. Now, given one of these groups that I'm willing to look at, and some element and the measure mu, which is A invariant on G mod gamma, I'm going to construct a system of conditional measures, some system of conditional measures which are indexed by a point in G mod gamma. So formally it's a map. So formally, this is a Borel measurable map. This is a Borel measurable map. From my space G mod gamma to some space of measures. Some space of locally finite measures on my group U up to multiplicative constant. So let me write exactly what is this space. So basically I said it's locally finite measures on U with some gross condition. There's some positive function on my space U, which is guaranteed to be integrable. And once I have such a function, then when I divide by the constants, I still have a nice space. Otherwise, you might worry that this quotient space is not nice. And if you start studying maps to not nice spaces, you get distinctly not nice complications. What have I done wrong?
So far you haven't formed that.
No, I have a space of measures and I'm dividing by constants. I'm identifying. It's a mild quotient, but it's, you have to be careful about these things. I can give quite a few false proofs of Rosenberg's conjecture about times 2 times 3 if I'm sufficiently uncareful about such things. Here are some basic properties of this construction. So, this is not a defining property, but it's sort of a nice feature of this. This is not just an arbitrary Borel map, it's in this, in those sort of, it has nice properties. So the group, this group that I have, this group of unipotent groups that I chose, and the diagonal group which normalizes it, so it together forms some nice solvable group, certainly acts on G mod gamma, it's a subgroup. And also on the space of measures. The U part acts on the space of measures simply by translating. And since A normalizes U, if I apply some element of A, it acts on the space by appropriately contracting, expanding, by conjugating U. So I have here a group which acts both here and here. And the map X goes to mu XU is, in this sense, I considered before, the factor map for this. Right? It's, if you like, commutes with this action. So that's one important feature. But that, of course, doesn't allow me to realize what, this is just saying that whatever this system of measures is, it's a nice object. It sort of has nice properties. It's maybe worthy to study it. But it does not say how to identify these measures. This you could give by the following definition. So now suppose C is a local cross section for the U action on G mod gamma. This just means it's a Borel set. So this basically means it's a Borel set. Such as the map, if I take the map B, let's say, from some ball in the group U around the identity. So this is some ball in the group U around the identity times my local cross section. I take goes to U, so given to G mod gamma, given by U C goes to U C, right? My cross section lives in G mod gamma. I want this map to be is basically a inject. It's going to be an homomorphism, if you like, or anyway, it's a Borel map whose injective Borel map whose image is going to be some open set in G mod gamma. Injective and contains image contains open set. So this is what it means to be a cross section, and yeah, so I need to explain what I want to use this cross section for. Then there exists a measure nu, a Borel measure on Xi, so that if I take mu, my measure, and restrict it to the image of beta, it's going to be the integral of these leafwise measures. So I'm sort of either some kind of abuse of notation here. These measures are not really measures, they're measures up to a constant. So basically I need to somehow choose a way to actually get measures out of them. And I mean, if I chose a different way, I would get a different Borel measure, but since it didn't tell you which measure to take, everything, it's maybe an abuse of notation, but it's not a real not a real crime. So that's somehow they're defined. And maybe another property which will be crucial for us, suppose now you can look for every one of these measures, you could look at those elements of the unipotent group U which preserves it. So suppose I look at the group, it's a closed group, closed subgroup of the group U. Let's maybe call it I mu, and U and X somewhere, I don't know. Whatever. But it's a group of elements which preserve my leafwise measure. So suppose that this is non-trivial. On a set of positive measure. Yes, on X. So, I mean, what happens on a set of zero measures basically doesn't make much sense in this category. So, basically, I'm saying essentially that suppose that there is one point that I can somehow brush under the rug at which this group is non-trivial. Then, my measure mu is invariant, at least I assumed here that I'm ergodic under the big action. Mu is invariant under a one-parameter subgroup unipotent subgroup of the unipotent group U. Now that's sort of nice. I mean, this is once I have invariance on an unipotent group, I can celebrate. So first of all, such mu are classified by famous results of Marina Radan. In fact, somehow, if you see how Marina Ratner proves her theorem, so the basic idea there is also basically you have some unipotent group, you want to get more one parameter unipotent group. So, I mean, basically, certainly once you get invariance under under some new one parameter unipotent group, then you are exceedingly pleased with yourself. So, these are the important properties of these systems of leafwise measures. Now, there is, so now I can explain one thing why, so I talked about leafwise measures, those nice objects. I would explain soon how these nice objects can be used to provide, provide unipotent invariance. But I want to relate the discussion of leafwise measures to entropy. And for that, I'm going to give a theorem which I'll say is maybe, I don't know who to attribute to. So I write it as folklore, but somehow it's not really folklore. It's just, it's basically something that, it's basically, I think, probably due to Kolmogorov, Sina, and Rochlin at the beginning days of entropy theory. So suppose mu is A invariant plus ergodic measure on G mod gamma, on some G mod gamma, and the A is an element of the action, then the following are equivalents. And that's somehow how leafwise, how entropy comes into the picture. Leafwise measures are sort of very natural. They are sort of obvious that you want to look at them. But entropy is not so obvious. And the connection is exactly that. Positive entropy for this element is exactly equivalent. It means no more, no less under this ergodicity assumption than if you look at these system of leafwise measures for the corresponding horospherical group, that these are not almost surely the most boring measure you could imagine, the delta measure at the origin. And somehow, if they are not almost surely the most boring measure you could imagine, then they're actually almost surely quite dramatic measures in some sense. They're infinite measures. So the total measure is infinite. They're locally finite, these measures, but the group is big, so they have room to be infinite. So if they're not somehow almost surely the most boring, they're actually quite colorful, almost surely. So that's somehow why entropy comes into the picture.
This was in Rudolph's
work. So Rudolph this definitely is in Rudolph's work and is not in Lyon's work. Rudolph constructs these leafwise measures, or he doesn't call them by this name, and they're sort of the key feature in his work. So definitely this is how Rudolph uses entropy. Now, so I have these, so this measure is quite a big measure, but it might somehow actually lie, I mean, this is a measure on a group, but maybe it lies on a subgroup, and that's actually quite important for the dynamics. So I already looked at sort of the group of invariants, which, of these leafwise measures, but now let's look at another group. So for u in this nice class of unipotent groups, I'll define somehow the supporting group of form u along u is the smallest Zariski connected subgroup containing the support of this leafwise measure. So, I mean, it seemingly depends on the point x, but because of ergodicity and this intertwining property of the system of leafwise measures, in fact, this A does not depend on x almost surely, and B is normalized by A almost surely. So this is does not depend on x, despite seemingly does not depend on x, and is automatically normalized by A. Other than that, it's sort of quite an interesting thing to understand what it is. Something bad has happened to this device. Hopefully it's still functioning. So this is somehow, let's think of this. You could think of this thing, this is somehow the observable part of the observable part. Of u, right? Observable given my measure mu. And basically, positive entropy right, and exactly for some element A implies that actually equivalent that for some, let's say this way, for some element of the action is equivalent to having this observable part non-trivial for some u. And this is not so obvious, but in fact it's enough to look you don't look at all u's, but only on the minimal ones for some coarse Lyapunov. Okay. So that's the positive entropy. But the joining assumption gives a much stronger condition on this support, and that's somehow a key reason that the reason why we could say more in joining than in the general case. The joining assumption gives positive entropy. Positive entropy gives me that one of these observable groups is non-trivial, but in fact I know much more. So we are in the joining situation. So suppose we are in the joining situation. In joining situation. So I have mu on some product, gi mod gamma I, projecting to uniform measure. On each one of the factors. Now, given some element A in A, or phi of A, given some element A, which is the image of some element in my two-parameter group. This group for the full, this whole spherical group for A is just going to be the product I from 1 to R of the whole spherical group in each one of these GIs for this element it's a product group. And because the whole spherical groups are product groups, every element of in this collection of groups that I like is of the form product of UIs, the UI is inside GI. Now, I didn't say, of course, that nobody said that any one of these groups is non-trivial, but it's a product. And actually, if it's one of these groups is trivial, that in some ways a much simpler case. Which brings me to a key lemma. So that's actually one of the, this is the reason why the joining is much easier, but actually this result that I'm presenting about joinings is the second paper Manfred and I are writing on joinings. We had this lemma we had in the previous one. I was hoping to explain the other sort of key piece of good luck we have in this case. But anyway, so this is somehow one of the two things I wanted to explain. It's not a hard lemma, but I don't think it's completely, it's not a complete formality, I think. It's not a hard thing or a very deep thing. But then for any U product of UI in this collection of good unipotent groups, I take the projection of the support of this group, sort of smallest, this observable part of my group U, which depends on my measure, it's in some subgroup of this product, I project it to the ith component, it would be equal to UI. So not only do I have that these observable parts are non-trivial, they're actually quite large. And it's in some sense seems like triviality. I mean, it's basically my measure projects, so why shouldn't these leafwise measures project? And perhaps there is some, but I mean, I just want to somehow say a small note that as far as I know, I do not know how to prove this for some product which is not in U. In this class of good sets a priori. After I classify the joinings, I can know explicitly what these things are. This happens to be true, but a priori, I mean, the only way I know how to prove, let's say I know only for these groups in this nice class a priori. Okay, as usual, plan to say much more, but okay, I got to one point which was important for me to explain. I will take maybe a couple of minutes to explain another key another nice to another observation in the proof. So there are basically two ways to produce we know of to produce unipotent invariants in this context. So one of them is somehow exploiting non-commutativity. Of these of horospheres, but of course, in order to be able to exploit the non-commutativity of the horosphere, you need the observable part of the horosphere to be also non-commutative. And that somehow goes by, this is something that Einsiedler and Katok developed. Sometimes we call it the high entropy method. Now, the other method is closer to the techniques of Ratner to study unipotent measures. So, and it's based on an observation and its sort of starting point is the following observation. Suppose there are two nearby points. Suppose X and X bar are nearby. So they're close to each other, they're somehow typical. Then, because my leafwise measure is a Borel map, and Borel maps are secretly continuous, you expect somehow that the leafwise measures would be close to each other. There's no surprise there. But somehow, if they are not just close, but they're actually equal on the nose, this is surprising information. This is a surprising information, and because I mean somehow they are really the same, they would stay the same if you move around by this solvable group I had before, A semi-direct product with U. So, I mean, if I have two measures which are almost the same, then I move them by some drastic, I sort of apply some drastic element of my solvable group, they will no longer be close to each other. But if they're on the nose the same, I can do whatever I want, they would have to stay the same. They're sort of trapped. That's the starting point of this, what's called the low entropy method. And in the context of a measure with positive entropy where we didn't know anything else, the best we could find are nearby points x prime with mu x for these minimal, for u coarsely Lyapunov, for these minimal good groups. But in this joining theorem, we can actually find nearby points, which have the same leafoid measure for a full horospherical group. And that's much easier to handle with mu. U, a horospherical, not a maximal horospherical. Not all horospherical comes the same size. A horospherical which is somehow smaller, but still a full horospherical group, and that somehow dynamics and horospherical groups is much easier than general unipotent dynamics. Okay, thank you.